Like maps. So we consider the space of all quadratic like maps up to affine conjugacy. This is a nice analytic space. The renormalization operator would be iteration and restriction. Both are very analytic operations. So the renormalization operator would itself be analytic. And it will be contracting. So if we have two maps that are hybrid conjugate, then the renormalizations will also be hybrid conjugate, and the quasi-conformal distance will be smaller. A caveat is that the dimension of this space is infinite. Well, and our goal is, again, to find a fixed point, or more generally, a renormalization horseshoe. And for that, we do want some compactness property, because since our space is infinite dimension, we can't go far without any compactness property. And it is often called a priori bounds in the subject. And what happens is that often a priori bounds can be established in the near-degenerate regime. And this is the main topic of my subject. I think I have some echo. Okay, not anymore. Okay, so I'd like first to summarize what is known about the near-degenerate regime for the Thurston and quadratic-like renormalization theory, and then I'll move to the neutral renormalizations. A fundamental fact about Riemann surfaces is that they degenerate along thin annuli and wide rectangles. A more familiar case is the situation with compact Riemann surfaces, perhaps punctured by finitely many points. So in this case, the surface degenerates along long thin annuli. So it is called the thin thick decomposition. And if we have, on the other hand, a Riemann surface with a boundary, so let's assume that we have some Jordan domain in the complex plane minus finitely many Jordan domains, then such object degenerates along finitely many wide rectangles. So it is more convenient to draw not the realistic picture, but a schematic one. So let's apply Photoshop and replace all wide rectangles with narrow rectangles. So the convention from now on would be that narrow on pictures means wide in reality. So this is because we are interested in homotopical properties of wide rectangles. So in the Thurston theory, when we iterate, if under the iteration we develop long annuli, then there is a Thurston matrix that controls the degeneration. So first of all, if the degeneration develops, then it develops along invariant multicurve. And applying the Grotje inequality, we easily obtain an estimate from below of the moduli of the analyte of the pullback through the Thurston matrix and the moduli of the surface before the pullback. And in fact, in the degenerate situation, this inequality can be effectively reversed and replaced by equality, perhaps with an additive correction. Well, this is because, well, our map on analyte is a covering map, and we understand what's happening with covering maps. And the map on thick parts would belong to some compact set. And this is the idea of how we establish an invariant compact set under the Thurston iteration. So of course I skipped a lot of details. But in the quadratic-like case, so I'm going to consider the primitive bounded case, and I will discuss the argument by Jeremy Kahn. So let's consider some quadratic polynomial and assume that we are in the degenerate situation. So the modulus between U and J is very small. So let's apply renormalization and replace the Julia set by a cycle of small Julia sets. And our task, our goal is to understand what are the white rectangles between small Julia set and the external boundary, and then try to catch the contradiction. And as we can see on the picture, there are two types of white rectangles, or horizontal, that connect two small Julia sets, and vertical. And remember that in the Thurston case, the degeneration develops along an invariant multicurve. Well, same story here, that horizontal rectangles must be developed along an invariant graph that connects small Julia sets. But it's folklore that the only invariant graph that contains, that connects small Julia set is the Hubbard tree. So therefore, horizontal rectangles must be developed along the Hubbard tree. But we can say even more. So if we consider the associated PCF model, so it has the Hubbard tree. So we can look at the corresponding matrix. Well, and just like the Thurston matrix controls what is happening with long annuli in the pullback iteration, this matrix controls what's happening with the horizontal rectangles. And in particular, if we apply a Grotje type inequality, and if we assume that the core entropy of of F restricted to the Hubbard tree is positive, then it would tell us that there are not too many white horizontal rectangles. So if we assume that there are no vertical rectangles, then this would already leads to a contradiction, well, more or less same argument as in the Thurston case. But a correct statement is that vertical white rectangles must form a substantial part of all white rectangles.
Proving something.
So horizontal rectangles cannot dominate.
So
this is a key step in the Jeremy's argument for the MLC for bounded primitive parameters.
Dima, you are proving something. What are you trying to prove? What is the statement?
Well, I'm trying to make an analogy between the quadratic like renormalization and Thurston.
But you're making an argument that something is a contradiction of something. What is the statement that you're trying to prove?
Well, the statement is this, that the vertical rectangles form a substantial part of all white rectangles. So if you take, so there will exist a constant C, so that if we sum up, yes?
What rectangles?
So if we sum up all widths of a...
What are these rectangles?
Well, rectangles, these are rectangles that are in the synthetic decomposition of the Riemann surface. When we take U and she remove the cycle of small Julia sets. So this is a Riemann surface with a boundary. So this surface has the synthetic decomposition. Well, elements of this synthetic decompositions will be white rectangles. And the statement is that, well, there was two statements, is that these white rectangles that are horizontal are aligned with the Hubbard tree. And the second statement is that if we sum up the widths of vertical rectangles, then this would form a substantial part of all rectangles.
Dima?
Right. Yeah.
So I'm trying, you said we have to Photoshop the picture you're drawing.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to do this in my brain. Let me see whether I got it right. The blue rectangles.
Yeah.
Contrary to what you've drawn, mean that this little Julia sets are much closer to each other than kind of their diameter. Is this correct?
Yeah, so this is the realistic picture.
Well, this is the other kind, but the blue ones, the horizontal
ones. Yeah, similar with blue.
So the idea is that the little Julia sets are closer to each other than their diameter by some order of magnitude. And so this is two boundary components, and the other boundary components are from the little Julia sets to the outer ellipse boundary, the boundary of U. And here you're saying again that the little Julia sets are closer to the boundary of U than their diameter.
Well, yeah, you can say it in this way.
And I'm trying to Photoshop my mental picture here.
Right, yeah.
And then you're saying of all the area in U that we see, minus the little Julia set, this is essentially filled by your rectangles. And you're saying, you want to say that a definite fraction is of these rectangles is between the little Julia sets and the boundary, as opposed to the blue ones between the Julia sets.
Correct, yeah.
Is this the statement that Hamel wanted?
What it means. I don't know why things are being called rectangles. And I've never seen this language before. And I just don't know what it is that's being talked about.
Horizontal sides on these disks or on the boundary of the big disk. Assume that you have a disk with several holes, just a few holes. So a rectangle is a topological rectangle whose horizontal sides on the boundary of this Riemann surface. That is a rectangle.
Yeah.
And then you can, so it is just a topological rectangle whose horizontal sides are on the boundary of our Riemann surface in topological and non-trivial guise. And the statement is the degeneration of such Riemann surfaces happens when these rectangles, some of these rectangles, become white. And so that is the issue of renormalization theory, as Dima was trying to convey, is to prevent this degeneration, this kind of degeneration. And it is in a way very much similar to how Thurston prevents degeneration along long tubes in the case of compact Riemann or Riemann surface of finite type, finite geometric type. So.
Okay. Well, in fact, this is what I wanted to say about the quadratic-like renormalization. So, namely, I wanted to make up this parallel that if we look at what's happening, then the argument is indeed kind of very close to what's happening in the Thurston iteration. And that's kind of one of the key steps, if not the key step, in Jeremy Kahn proof of the MLC in the primitive bounded case. So an important tool is the covering lemma developed by Jeremy and Misha. And in the follow-up work, Misha and Jeremy pushed the theory much further. So now it handles quite well the primitive case, assuming that we are kind of uniformly away from the molecule. So roughly speaking, assuming that the core entropy is at least some epsilon. So roughly what they did, they translated all the theory of the primitive renormalization into the language of the near-degenerate regime. Yeah, and establish a priori bounds under such kind of condition. Okay, so more details will be tomorrow in Misha's talk. So this is just before the Boulanes. So please come to Boulanes. So let me also make a comment about the Thurston theory. So there is another approach to the renormalization, to the realization problem by Dylan. So he was talking about it yesterday. And in some sense, the near-degenerate regime is even more explicit in his situation. So he starts with a map between graphs. So then he replaces graphs with a small neighborhood. So this will be a very degenerate Riemann surface. And then he does the realization for this degenerate Riemann surfaces, and then after that he does the surgery and obtains a post-critically finite rational map. So Kevin and Dylan will be given a Zoom mini course in November on the renormalization and dynamics seminar. So everyone who is interested to the subject is welcome to join. Okay, good. So and now I'd like to go to the near neutral renormalization theory. So this is the theory associated with the boundary of the main hyperbolic component. So here are some examples of maps. So all of them are Ziegle disks, but some of the Ziegle disks are degenerate. So this is the golden Ziegle disk. So the Ziegle disk is a quasi disk that rotates around the center. So this Ziegle disk has the rotation number that is very close to zero. So it is still a quasi disk, but the center of rotation will be very, very close to the boundary. So here, the rotation number is close to 1/2. And then the Ziegle disk will be like this. So it will start to develop parabolic fjords. But still, it's kind of a nice object. So as I will talk later. So and here, the rotation number is close to 1/4. And we can see that the Ziegle disk has 4 parabolic fjords. So it rotates, so it's not, well, it wants to degenerate, and it develops parabolic fjords. So there are several reasons, or there are many reasons why we might be interested in the neutral renormalization. First, the neutral renormalization controls the quadratic-like renormalization near the cardioid. So this is where the primitive renormalization theory fails. So it requires certain adjustments. So in particular, there is no good theory of puzzles near the boundary of the main cardioid. Well, also, near-neutral renormalization is very much related to the theory of near-circle maps, and such maps were in the focus for a long time. Well, perhaps even from the beginning of the dynamical systems, when the dynamical systems were motivated by the celestial mechanics, like planets moving around the sun. Well, and since we like the transcendental dynamics, at least on this conference, well, a good news is that the transcendental dynamics also emerges on the unstable manifolds. So this is kind of one way how we can understand combinatorics of a neutral renormalization. Namely, the combinatorics can be described using this particular map. So this is the Julia set of this cubic polynomial. So it has a parabolic point here, and it attracts one critical point, and another critical point is here, and it maps to the fixed point under one iteration, S2:1. So this field Julia set is very similar to the molecule. And in fact, if we endow the molecule with the Branner-DoD surgery, and I will refer to the resulting map as the molecule map, then this should be conjugate to this topologically. Well, and in fact, this is equivalent to the MLC conjecture, the satellite case, that these two dynamical systems are topologically conjugate. And the Branner-DoD surgery, well, let me kind of describe the idea on the case with rabbits. So if we have a peak over Q rabbit, So it's the rabbit that rotates with this rotational number. Then, assuming that p is smaller than q over 2, we can remove dynamically p es from the rabbit. So we do the surgery. Well, and then after the DOD Brunner surgery, we obtain another rabbit which will have the rotation number p over q minus p. Well, and if p is bigger than q over 2, then well, we symmetrized the construction. Well, and we also map the basilica hyperbolic component into the main hyperbolic component using the basilica straightened map. So everything assembles into a continuous map around the main molecule, and the MLC conjecture of the satellite case says that this must be topologically conjugate to this molecule. And periodic points on the main hyperbolic component of the molecule map are exactly Ziegler maps of periodic type. Alternatively, we can describe Ziegler maps of periodic type using continuous fraction expansion. So this is the periodic point of the smallest period. So here is period 2 of the molecule map. So this periodic cycle is formed by the golden Ziegler parameters. So the upper golden Ziegler parameters and the lower Ziegler parameter. So once we have a periodic point, we should expect self-similarity, because around periodic points, we may want to linearize everything. And this is indeed what happens with the Mandelbrot set. So if we zoom in at the golden Ziegler parameter, then we see self-similarity. So this zoom is almost indistinguishable from the zoom next level. So this is called universality. The combinatorial reason is because the golden Ziegler parameter is a periodic cycle. But of course, in order to justify this self-similarity properly, we need to develop the renormalization theory. Let me also make a remark that if we consider some other parameter space, for example, the space of quadratic rational maps, where one of the critical points is two-periodic, and if we zoom in at the corresponding golden Ziegler parameter, then again, this picture becomes almost indistinguishable from the corresponding picture of the Mandelbrot set. And then the scaling will be with the same universal constant lambda star. So here would also be. Well, and in fact, both of these pictures converge to the limit in transcendental dynamics. And the limit in transcendental dynamics can be used in order to identify these pictures. Well, at least partially, but hopefully in the future, there would be a complete identification. Okay, so this is a summary of the neutral renormalization theory. So the first conjectures appeared in the 80s. So that was the time when many physicists discovered many interesting facts. So mathematicians call them conjectures. Kurt McMullen constructed renormalization Ziegle periodic points associated with Ziegle disks of periodic type. He also showed the exponential contraction. So Ina and Shishikura proved hyperbolicity of the near parabolic renormalization. So this renormalization controls what happens in the neighborhood of a parabolic point. And this was important for the theory because hyperbolicity really allows to study nearby maps. So what they did, they proved hyperbolicity for the actual parabolic map. And since the hyperbolicity is an open condition, it also holds in a neighborhood, and it allows to study maps that were out of reach before. So for example, there are many applications to the area problem. So there is now kind of almost a full or complete topological understanding of the hedgehog of a Kramer parameter in the inner Shishikura class. So Kramer polynomials turns out to be not that complicated after all. Well, there are applications to the MLC conjecture in the satellite case, and also ergodic properties of neutral polynomials. So the original argument by Ina and Shishikura involved some computer assistance. Arno later presented a computer-free proof, and it also works for unicritical maps, also high type. Denis Gaidashev and Michael Yampolsky presented a computer assistant proof for the actual golden mean Ziegle disk, namely for this main periodic cycle. Well, then in a joint work with Misha and Nikita, we proved hyperbolicity for bounded type parameters. Well, we involved the Pacman renormalization. Well, and again, the hyperbolicity means that we can study nearby maps. So we understand quite well what is happening with periodic, with Ziegle disk of periodic type. And once we have hyperbolicity, we can study also nearby maps. And we obtain some applications to also scaling and area problems. And we constructed the first example of the MLC of the satellite bounded type. So let me also mention briefly the Dzhou-Dzigis surgery. So this is, So this is a way how we understand Ziegle disks of bounded type, because otherwise, kind of, we can't control their critical orbit. So the idea is that we start with the Blaschke product. So a Blaschke product restricts to a circle map, so it's going to be a critical circle map. And since the critical circle maps are quite well understood, so in particular, if our rotation number is of bounded type, then the restrictions to the circle will be QC conjugate to the rotation. Then this allows to apply a quasi-conformal surgery and obtain out of the Blaschke product a Ziegle polynomial of periodic type. So we forget the dynamics inside the unit disk and we do the surgery. And this is an essential bit for the surgery. And what's important is that we obtain a map where we control the post-critical orbit. So the post-critical orbit would be rotated on the boundary of the Ziegle quasi-disk. But there are limitations for this surgery because Well, the surgery cannot produce Kramer polynomials. Okay, so let me now state a theorem. So it's a joint work with Misha. So the theorem states that there are uniform a priori bounds for all neutral polynomials on the boundary of the hyperbolic component. So there are different ways of stating it. So let me first state kind of a rough version. So a rough version claims that when Ziegle disks of a bounded type degenerate, then they can degenerate only in a star-like way. So as we can see on the picture, so the degenerations has this type, but we don't see the degenerations like this. So this is we don't see on pictures. And this is the statement, so it can be made precise, but roughly speaking, when a Ziegle disk degenerate, then this is allowed. So this such degenerations is allowed, and it can also happen on all scales. So this is like scale, let's say one, and if we zoom in, then we would see more parabolic fjords, and still there would be star-like fashion. And this is not allowed. So a bit more precise way of stating it is that for any rotation number of a bounded type, but M can be any, the Ziegle disk, so this is our Ziegle disk that rotates, the Ziegle disk can be put inside a quasi disk with a uniform dilatation. Such that the degree of the map restricted to this enlarged quasi disk, so we call it pseudo Ziegle disk. So such that the degree is one of the map restricted to this to the Ziegle disk. And as a corollary, because quasi-conformal objects are compact, such a pseudo Ziegle disk exists for all neutral maps. So even for Kramer polynomials, so there would be a pseudo Ziegle disk that is sort of almost invariant, and this pseudo Ziegle disk would have an absolute dilatation. So these pseudo Ziegle disks are obtained by adding these parabolic fjords on all scales. So this is how we construct pseudo Ziegle disk.
Dima, it's not really visible.
So roughly speaking, out of a star, we can produce a
Dima, could you, Dima, could you please repeat your drawing, because it was not very visible. It's all dark.
Oops. So, is it better now? Are you talking about this?
Yes.
But,
maybe you can make it closer to us.
Right, yeah. So is it better?
Yes, is it?
Right. So what I'm saying is that a pseudo Ziegle disk can be obtained by adding such parabolic fjords. Well, Length similar with other periodic Ziegler parameters. So whenever a parabolic fjord is developed, we can add it to the object. So, or saying it more schematically, so if we have a star, then we can add fjords between star and obtain a uniform QC disk. Right. And another way of stating a priori bounds is that there would exist a fiber-wise compact renormalization operator, cylinder renormalization operator around McMullen periodic points when we take the closure of McMullen periodic points. So this is renormalization horseshoe. So we take all McMullen periodic renormalization points, we take the closure, and the statement is that this will be a compact set of maps, and there would be a renormalization operator around this compact set of maps. So any questions about the statement? So any question at this stage? So before I'll try to give some ideas of the proofs. Okay, good. So as I said, the proof is in the near-degenerate regime. And here is like one basic idea is that suppose we have a Ziegler disk that rotates. And suppose we have two intervals I and j. And suppose that there is a white rectangle that connects them. So again, this is kind of a Photoshop, but in reality, this white rectangle will be like this. Well, now, if combinatorially we can pull back these two intervals I and j to intervals located like this, so between them. And if we assume that the critical value is not on the way, then we can pull back this white rectangle and obtain a white rectangle that cross-intersects the original white rectangle. And this is impossible because white rectangles do not cross-intersect. And this type of arguments allows to cover like a lot of cases. So a good half of all the arguments are based on this principle. So in particular, this type of arguments allows to understand the geometry of parabolic fjords. And let me now kind of try to give a cartoon proof kind of the logic. So this will be like a cartoon rough presentation of the main logic of the argument. But assume that we don't have uniform a priori bounds. So this means that we have a Ziegler disk that looks like this in reality. So like one peninsula comes very close to another peninsula. And then there is a white rectangle between these two peninsulas. So as I said, that we prefer to do schematic pictures. So if we apply the Photoshop, then we obtain, like we put our star back, but then we would have a white rectangle. between these two peninsula. Yeah, so white rectangles geometrically looks like this. Well, it's now this degeneration can be spread around. So the Ziegle disk rotates. So the covering lemma allows to kind of spread this degeneration around to more or less all the peninsula. Not more or less, but to all peninsulas. But now, if we try to spread this rectangle to a rectangle that connects this two peninsula, then this is impossible because white rectangles cannot cross intersect. So therefore, when we apply the covering lemma and move the original rectangle to the rectangle that connects this two peninsula, the new rectangle must go through the Ziegle disk. So it must submerge. Well, and this submergence could be understood because inside the unit disk, we have the complex structure of the standard disk that rotates. So in particular, these degenerations can be localized. So most of the degenerations would go like this. And like only O big of one of the degenerations would be beyond, well, would be below this. So we call these techniques like snakes. And we have several versions of the snake lemma. Right. Well, but now, after localizing, the degeneration, we can also observe that roughly this degeneration splits into two rectangles. And one of these rectangles should be twice wider than the original rectangle. So this allows kind of us to say that either this rectangle or this rectangle will be twice bigger than the original rectangle. So we can obtain from a degeneration, bigger degeneration. Well, and then this bigger degeneration could be put inside a fjord of inside a peninsula of a deeper scale. So here comes sort of the main logic that if we originally had a big degeneration, then we can find bigger and bigger degeneration at each step, and we can construct like a sequence of rectangles Rn so that each rectangle Rn will be 2 to the power n wider than the original rectangle. But such sequence cannot exist because we do have a non-uniform a priori bounds. So our Ziegle disk was of periodic type, so it might be kind of super degenerate, but still it is of periodic type and it has some a priori bounds. So therefore, this is impossible, and it implies that we cannot find such degenerations at first place. And that's kind of a rough kind of cartoon idea of the argument that allows to promote non-uniform bounds to uniform bounds. Okay, so let me make like a few final comments. Like first, kind of, as I said, we need to work with pseudo-Ziegler disk. So we add parabolic fjords to the Ziegler disk. And we do make such construction on all scales. Sort of, and part of the technicality is sort of to show that differential levels don't really interact much. So this, the way how we do it is by establishing a certain coarse a priori bounds. Well, another remark that kind of maybe like, let me say like about applications. So since this pseudo-Ziegler disk kind of exists for all data, so this would imply that kind of for every theta, there would be some Hitchcock. So let's say for every theta that is not rational, for every irrational theta, there will be a Hitchcock that contains the critical orbit. And fact that the degree is one. So we can't kind of claim at this stage the topology of that Hitchcock, but at least it would exist. And the degree will be one. So in particular, the post-critical set is not everything. So, which is an open question outside of the inner Shishikura class. But in the inner Shishikura class, so as I said, there is now full topological understanding of such objects. And yeah, hopefully, in the future, this topological understanding can be improved for all neutral polynomials. Let me stop here. Okay, thank you.
Are there any questions here or online? Okay, maybe I have a question. So Jeremy's philosophy was something like, if your life is bad today, then your life was even worse yesterday. And your philosophy is that if your life is bad today, then it will be even worse tomorrow.
Right.
So this is a joke, but do you have a dynamical or more like serious explanation why it goes another way?
I mean, the reason is this snake lemma. Because, well, in the Jeremy situation, well, let me go back to the Jeremy situation. Well, the Julia sets are disjoint, and he doesn't need to kind of understand kind of the boundary of each, the geometry near the boundary of each small Julia set. So he can kind of think that each small Julia set is roughly kind of a disk for this type of arguments. So here the Deagle disk is one object, so it is a connected object. So we need to kind of understand the ideal boundary of the Deagle disk with respect to the geometry outside of the Deagle disk. So this kind of leads us to understanding the submergence of the white rectangles inside the Deagle disk. And this sort of forces this philosophy that this us kind of forces to go into the deep scale instead of going into the shallow case, into the shallow scale. So this is really because we need to understand the submergence of white rectangles inside the Deagle disk. Yeah, so let me also mention that I gave a mini course, a four lecture mini course last December about more details of this type of argument. So it's available on the Simon Center video collection.
More questions?
Can I ask a question?
So
I'm wondering if you are also able to control the geometry of the fjords within this pseudo Deagle disk that you talked about. Yeah. So could, for example, the fjords start to say a spiral inside, a spiral about the fixed point, or to do other things?
Right. We don't. Right. Yeah. So in some sense, our arguments allow us to understand the external boundary. Sort of we. So our arguments sort of allow us to understand the external boundary of this pseudo Deagle disk, but we can't really say much, I guess, at this stage about what's happening at the around the fixed point. So we don't. We can't say how fjords would spiral. Right.
So, I mean, maybe a different question is, if I understand correctly, the pseudo Deagle disk contains, say, the first few iterates of the critical point.
Yeah.
Is this right? So maybe could I restate your theorem that for any like non-finite number m, there exists a k such that for any bound theta of bounded type, there is this pseudo Deagle disk which contains the first m iterates of the critical point.
Yes, this is correct. So we may need to kind of in enlarge k, the capital K, but yeah, by enlarging this absolute K, we can control more and more pseudo Deagle disks. We can control more and more the prosthetical orbit.
Yes, right. Because without like stating it like that, because it seems to me that there could be maybe a trivial example of a pseudo Deagle disk. You just take a closed curve which passes through the critical point, and the map restricts to a degree one map.
No, but
because your pseudo Deagle disk is not invariant.
Yeah, but pseudo Deagle disk does contain the original Deagle disk, and it is still kind of an open question. It was an open question, kind of. Why the boundary of the Deagle disk is not everything.
I have a question. about higher degree polynomials. So for instance, in the family of all degree three polynomials, would you right. also have a uniform K such that your theorem holds?
Right. Kind of what we really do, so we start with Ziegle disks that we understand with the that are non-uniform. So we start with QC disks that are non-uniform, and then we kind of provide a priori bounds for them. Well, now for cubics, if we consider a Ziegle disk of periodic type, perhaps a non-uniform that rotates. And this Ziegle disk contains both critical points on the boundary, then I would expect that the technique should be applicable, perhaps with minor modification. So in particular, such objects kind of are compact, or at least I would anticipate it. But in the cubic case, it may happen we know that one of the critical points must be on the boundary. This is thanks to Georgigis, Sogeri, and Schmitz showed how it can be applied in the multicritical for multicritical polynomials. So if we have a Ziegle disk of periodic type, then it must contain one of the critical points, but then another critical point must be sort of on the decorations. And this may be kind of a challenge, because if you wanted to understand all neutral cubic polynomials, then we wanted to understand also Kramer parameters that are obtained by taking limits of these objects.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, let us thank the speaker again.